Good morning, church family. Oh, you can do better than that. Good morning, church family. Oh, I like that much better. It's good to have you all here in worship today. It's good to know that we have a nice crowd of children downstairs that are having Sunday school right now, their rally day. They've got breakfast pizza and everything, but don't worry, we've got coffee up here. So if you want coffee, you're welcome to go ahead and get a cup of coffee, bring it to the pew, relax. After worship, you're welcome to get some also. Speaking of coffee, while we're talking about it, we need people to help do the coffee. If you want coffee every week, we need people to help do that. So make sure that you sign up for that. You can do that on your Connect card. Speaking of the Connect card, you can find that in your bulletin, or you can find it next to the video on the webpage on YouTube, on Facebook. There we go. And you can find it there, and you can submit it. You can sign up for a time to share coffee with everybody. It's not very hard, just takes a little bit of time to prepare and then to clean up afterwards. Our Connect cards will be collected right after the call to worship today. During that sharing of the Thanksgiving, the gratitude testimony, that's when the ushers will come forward and receive those. So you want to go ahead and fill those out. Someday we'll each face death, won't we? We talked about that 2 weeks ago. And death will not get the last word. We talked about that last week. But what do we expect? A preacher and a taxi driver ended up in heaven at the same time at the gates, and the taxi driver came in, and boy, there was a big celebration, and he got wonderful clothes and a big mansion, and the preacher thought, oh, all right, here we go. And the preacher comes up to the gate, and he gets, a robe and a little shack, and he's going, what's going on here? He asks Peter, what's going on? Peter looks through the big book, see. Well, he says, well, it says here, while the taxi driver was driving, people were praying. While you were preaching, they were sleeping. We might not always get what we expect when we go to heaven, but what should we expect? What should we expect when we get to heaven? That's what we're going to talk about today. That's what we're going to talk about as we throughout worship and then for the sermon today. So let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we listen to the prelude this morning.
Good morning. Please rise and join me in the call to worship. Today's call to worship will involve reading, and then we will also be singing a verse after each reading from the hymn, Shall We Gather at the River, which is page 723. Come one and all, gather together, for this is the day of the Lord. Let's gather at the river by the throne of God, for there is a blessing forever. Flows a mighty river of peace and hope for all of God's people. And there shall be rejoicing at the sight of the healing water. Our journey brings us to God's wondrous river of life. Praise be to God who has drawn us from darkness and filled our world with light.
prayers today go out to all those who are ill, those who are struggling, those who are grieving. We want to lift up particularly Jason, who will be having knee surgery on Tuesday, Les as he begins new treatments, Barb Heston as she recovers from her treatment, and Emmett, who's in the hospital. We also lift up all of our children who are in Sunday school, the teachers, Susie, the director, and all those who are helping with the education ministries. Let us pray. God, you are a good God, and we give you thanks. You have brought us to this place and this time. As Sunday school starts, as youth group starts, as confirmation starts, as many Methodists start, as all of the fall programs and ministries are beginning here at the church, sometimes it's exhausting. But we know that in the exhaustion, you are working. In the joy of the smiles coming in the wisdom that is shared, in the love that is shared, we give you thanks and we give you praise for all those who are serving in these programs in various ways. The youth leaders and Sunday school teachers and education directors, we give you thanks for all of those who are sharing in that. Lord, we give you all of the ministries of this church, all of the ongoing ministries as we visit people, as we share your word, as we perform outreach in the community, as we share our mission with others, as we generously give to places of disaster and need around the world, as we come together in worship, as we care for one another. May all of these ministries be for your glory, and may they draw us closer to you each day. Lord, we pray for our community. There are folks in our community who have needs that we don't even know. Draw us to them. Draw us to them so that we can know those needs and can help them. Draw us to them so we can pray for them. Draw us to them so we can be a companion to them along the way. And those whom we do know, give us grace. Give us grace to treat them with love. Give us grace to offer our time. Give us grace to be the people who will journey with them through their illness. Lord, we pray for our country and our world. There are always so many things to pray for, and we remember natural disasters almost every week, but they come so often. We pray today also for those who are missing. I was reading about a woman who was washed down the Poudre River in a flash flood out in Colorado this week. Actually, 2 weeks ago. They're still looking for her. We pray for families who are missing loved ones and children and others. Lord, surround us with your grace and your love as we minister this week. Fill our families with a sense of your presence each and every day. And Lord, hear our worship of praise, thanksgiving. Our words, our songs are all for you. All of this we pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 9 through 27. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came and said to me, "Come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb." And in the spirit he carried me away to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city Jerusalem coming down out of the heaven from God. It has the glory of God and a radiance like a very rare jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. It has a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and on the gates are inscribed the names of the 12 tribes of the Israelites. On the east 3 gates, on the north 3 gates, on the south 3 gates, and on the west 3 gates, and on the wall of the city has 12 foundations, and on them are the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The angel who talked to me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city and its gates and walls. The city lies four square, its length the same as its width, and he measured the city with his rod 1,500 miles. Its length and width and height are equal. He also measured its wall 144 cubits by human measurement, which the angel was using. The wall is built of jasper, while the city is pure gold, clear as glass. The foundations of the wall of the city are adorned with every jewel. The first was jasper, the second sapphire, the third agate, the fourth emerald, the fifth onyx, the sixth carnelian, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, the 12th amethyst. And the 12 gates are 12 pearls. Each of the gates is a single pearl, and the street of the city is pure gold, transparent as glass. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need for sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. People will bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations. But nothing unclean will enter it, nor anyone who practices abomination or falsehood, for only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life.
What will you be doing in heaven? Interesting question. It's easy to imagine Grandma maybe being the pie baker in heaven, or Grandpa being the golf player who goes round after round after round of eternal golf on the most wonderful course ever. Now, I don't know much about heaven, but I think when I get to heaven, I'm going to be eating chocolate chip cookies. Chocolate chip cookies. Jar after jar after jar of chocolate chip cookies. Is there anything better in the world than a warm chocolate chip cookie? But I'll tell you, after 40 years preaching, I've studied, I've looked, I've gone into the Greek and the Hebrew, I've studied all the words that Jesus said, I've looked at the etymologies, and nowhere in the Bible does the word chocolate chip appear. I don't know why. Because when Jesus was multiplying something, he should have multiplied chocolate chip cookies instead of bread. When God was feeding the Israelites, he should have fed them chocolate chip cookies instead of manna. I think heaven is going to be filled with chocolate chip cookies. I'm being a little facetious, of course. The point being that we trivialize heaven so much. We trivialize heaven when we think of foods or cookies or golf or whatever it is. And heaven's so much greater than anything we can imagine. We take heaven and we try to plant it in a little spot here on earth when it's so much greater than anything we could ever imagine. And I don't know what heaven's going to be like exactly. I'm going to share some things with you today. I wish I knew a little bit more, and someday I think I will. There are others who can tell us a little bit about heaven, they say. There are folks, you know, who have died and gone to heaven, and they come back and tell their story. Now, a lot of those people, I'm very skeptical. I'm very skeptical because they seem to be playing on the nominal Christians. They seem to be giving false hope. They might be writing just to make a buck. But once in a while, I come across one that touches me. And maybe you guys are familiar with the story, Heaven is for Real. For some reason, I don't know why that's different than others, for some reason, Kevin Beppel's story of his son's, Colton's, experience in heaven just touches me differently. Maybe it's because I've seen Colton interviewed, and he's a young man that just has a lot of integrity, and I just believe what he says. I love that story. Now, maybe I'm wrong, but I do love that story, and I remember a couple things. I remember when he went to his parents, and Colton said, did you know I have an older sister? Well, no, you don't. You have a younger sister. He said, no, I met her in heaven, and she died in your tummy. Well, he had no way of knowing at that age that his parents had a miscarriage, and he told his mother that it was a girl and what her name was. The parents didn't know the gender of the child, so they didn't give the child a name. But what an experience that was. The other favorite part of that story is that Colton is showed picture after picture after picture of Jesus. When he goes to church, he sees a picture of Jesus, says, that's not what he looks like. He sees one in the Bible, that's not what he looks like. He sees one on the wall at home, that's not what he looks like. But one day, he was shown the picture called The Prince of Peace, drawn by Akian Karamek. She was eight years old when she painted that. It took her 40 hours. She had a similar experience to Colton in that she died, went to heaven, and came back. This is what she saw. When he saw this picture, watch his reaction from the movie.
It's about a girl on the other side of the world who had an experience a lot like Colton's. She saw visions of heaven. Look at this, angels.
She began to describe to her mother in great detail.
Look at this, honey. This is incredible.
Her visits to heaven.
It's nice, honey, but I gotta talk to you.
Okay, but she's... At the age of four, she began to describe her visits to heaven. See?
Cole? You okay?
That's him.
His reaction, his mouth drops open, he says, that's him. That's him. If you want to know more about Akian's story, I put a link on YouTube. She has quite a video that tells about this painting that she drew and what's happened since then. Now, believe it or not, that's up to you. That story touches my heart, though. And I like to think that there are people who can tell us more about what heaven is than I know. But I also know the Bible tells us a lot more about heaven than any of us know. So let's look at what the Bible has to tell us. We start with John chapter 14, where Jesus says, "In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told what I've told you, that I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also." It won't surprise you to know the first thing the Bible says is heaven is for real, to borrow the title from the movie. Heaven is real. Jesus says, I've been there, I've seen it, I've got it ready for you, I've made reservations for you, and I'm going to come back and get you when it's your time. Jesus has no qualms about that. He just says with absolute certainty, he doesn't falter, he doesn't stutter. He says, heaven's for real, and I'm going to take you there. He also says to the thief who's hanging beside him on the cross the day that he dies, he says, truly today, I tell you, you'll be with me in paradise. Paradise, heaven. Today you'll be with me. Jesus promises with absolute certainty. The scripture promises with absolute certainty that eternal life is real. Heaven is real for those who believe and those who live Jesus' way. Heaven is absolutely real. The second thing the scripture says is there's a connection between heaven and this life. There's a connection between this life and the next life that sometimes we don't quite get. Jesus was preaching in the synagogue, and he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he anointed me to preach good news to the poor." Good news to the poor. "He sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And then he stepped back, and he closed the scroll, and he sat down, which is a teaching position in the synagogue, and he said, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Now, what would Jesus call all that, the freeing the oppressed and healing the lame and all that? He calls it the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven. Now, the kingdom of heaven, as I read it, is whenever the Lord's prayer becomes true, when God's will is done on earth as it is in heaven. That's when the kingdom of heaven is with us. When God's will is done on earth as it is in heaven, that's when the kingdom of God becomes real among us. That's when heaven stoops down and becomes part of our everyday lives. You see, right now, I told you last week, when you're baptized, we're baptized into Christ's death and Christ's resurrection. We're baptized into eternal life. And right now, we live a little taste of that eternal life. A little taste of eternal life in the things that we do. And what we do will affect our eternal life, of course. Jesus talks about this again in Matthew 25, when he is talking about a judge, and the judge is separating the sheep from the goats. And what's the criteria he's using? Did you feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the prisoner, visit the sick? That's the criteria he's using. He says, if you did those things, he says, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. That's a promise. Come, be part of that eternal life. Be part of that heaven that God has created for us from the beginning of the world. It's all connected, this life and the next, through the Holy Spirit of God that dwells in us now and will give us life when we are resurrected. The miracle of heaven coming to earth, the miracle of God's will being done on earth as it is in heaven, is heaven being real to us today. So the first thing the scripture says is that heaven is real. The second thing it says is it starts today. The last thing the scripture says about it, we turn to the book of Revelation. And we turn to Revelation because the book of Revelation is filled with beautiful imagery and metaphors and poetry. When I teach the confirmation class, I tell them we need to read the book of Revelation as if we're reading a poem. We don't read it literally word for word. We read it as a poem. We read the images. We read the message behind the words. And the message behind the words is as close as we can get to heaven, because the experience of heaven is so far beyond our imagination, so far beyond our human ability to comprehend, so far beyond what we believe is possible, that the metaphor, the poem, is our best way to understand and describe heaven. In chapter 5 of Revelation, we have this image of being able to maybe peek into God's living room, you might say. We get to peek into God's living room in heaven, and what do we see? We see all the heavenly creatures gathered around the throne. And around them, we see angels, thousands and thousands and tens of thousands, plus tens of thousands of angels gathered around the throne. And around them, every creature from heaven and on earth and under the earth, and the sea creatures and all that is in them. And what are they doing? Singing. They're singing around the throne of God. They're singing to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Heaven has to be filled with music. Heaven has to be filled with music. Probably music that's better than we've ever heard. As wonderful as we experience this wonderful music here, as much as we enjoy it, can you imagine what heavenly music is going to be like? Robin was just reminding me, I'd heard this story before. It had been a while since she had mentioned it. Someone that she heard once that said that she had this trip to heaven, she came back, and heaven ruined her experience of music on earth because heavenly music was so much more beautiful, she couldn't enjoy the earthly music anymore. I think one of the best ways to imagine heaven is that it's filled with music. Filled with musical praise. And then we turn to chapter 21. Chapter 21 has this wonderful image of a city coming down. And what is this city? Well, it's not just a city on earth, because no city could be built like this. This is John's best description of heaven. He tries the best he can to describe what eternal life is going to look like. He says the walls are made of jasper, clear as crystal. There are 12 gates, each one made of a single pearl. One pearl for each gate, and they're perfect. He says, the wall of the city has 12 foundations. And the measuring rod that they use for the city is of pure gold. It's 1,500 miles this way and this way and this way. He says that the foundations of the city, and that's the part that you usually don't see that's under the ground, they're filled with gems. All the gems of Sandra read for us, those are on the foundation. People don't usually see those. The city doesn't need any temple. It doesn't need any temple because God is there. And that's all that it needs. There is no darkness because God is the light that of all things. And there's no need to shut the gates because there's no danger coming. It's only God. And God all the time. What a beautiful image of what heaven is going to look like. I don't know how we'll experience heaven. I don't know what it'll feel like. But that's about as close as we can come. About as close as I can come as I imagine heaven, as I envision the city that John describes. And I envision the people who live there as God's people, you people, who share the eternal life that you have now and eternally with each other. Let me close with a quote by John MacArthur. It's been said, Scripture repeatedly makes it clear that heaven is a realm of unsurpassed joy, unfading glory, undiminished bliss. Nothing about it can possibly be boring or humdrum. It will be a perfect existence. We will have unbroken fellowship with all of heaven's inhabitants. Life there will be devoid of any sorrows, cares, tears, fear, or pain. Heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and glorious, He'll prepare for us a place.
I'm so glad you're able to be with us today in this online worship service. I invite you to come back anytime. Next week, we'll be in person and online at 10 o'clock Sunday morning again. You are God's people. You are God's people, filled with God's love, God's grace. Go share that love and grace with all those around you. Amen.